Romans chapter 9. And once again, we, of course, didn't have a large crowd last Sunday morning due to the weather and the blizzard conditions. But we actually did have a class for the handful of people that were able to make it last Sunday morning. What I want to do is concentrate this morning on one very specific objection that proponents of covenant theology will raise against what we as dispensationalists are teaching regarding the nation of Israel and the doctrine of the remnant, okay? So I don't want to review what we've already covered. I'm going to pick it up here in Romans chapter 9. Let's read verses 6 down through verse 13. And then we are going to concentrate on verse 7 specifically. Romans chapter 9, beginning there at verse 6, "Not as though the word of God hath taken none effect. For they are not all Israel, which are of Israel. Neither because they are the seed of Abraham are they all children, but in Isaac shall thy seed be called. That is, they which are the children of the flesh, these are not the children of God, but the children of the promise are counted for the seed. For this is the word of promise. At this time will I come, and Sarah shall have a son. And not only this, but when Rebekah also had conceived by one, even by our father Isaac, for the children being not yet born, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God, according to election, might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth. It was said unto her, the elder shall serve the younger, as it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated." And I just want to reiterate, what this passage is stressing is God's elective purpose. We are going to reject what theology says about election. This passage says nothing about God electing individuals to go to heaven, God electing individuals to spend eternity in hell. God didn't decide, I'm going to create Joe Smith to go to hell, nor did God decide, I'm going to create Susan Brown to go to heaven. In this context, it is absolutely clear, crystal clear, God's elective purpose is to call out from the physical Abrahamic lineage a spiritual seed. And that's what Paul is highlighting here in this passage. If you notice there in verse 13, as it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. That's a quote out of Genesis chapter 25, verse 23. Don't go there for sake of time. If you go back to Genesis 25, verse 23, God says that there are two nations in thy womb, okay? And through history, by the way, do you notice there in verse 6, not as though the word of God hath taken none effect. God's word was working. God's word was calling out from the ranks of physical, literal, biological Israel, a remnant of people that believe what God was doing. They were responding by faith to what God is doing. Hence, Paul, he says what he says there at the end of verse 11. Look at the end of verse 11. That the purpose of God, according to election, might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth. What God's word was working effectually. It was demonstrating that there is this biological seed line that ultimately becomes Edom. And Edom did what Esau did, hated the birthright. The Edomites, which represent apostate Israel, they hate the birthright. They hate what God intends to do there in the promised land with his holy seed, the born-again generation. So God's word is working by calling out those who respond by faith. They now become identified with this spiritual lineage. That is, and we've seen some things about this doctrine of the remnant, and we'll say a few more things here in just a minute. Now, for this morning, what I wanted to do is address a very common and strong objection to what the Bible teaches, what we certainly recognize, regarding spiritual Israel. Now, we've mentioned a couple of weeks ago that covenant theology, also known as Augustinian or Calvinistic theology. Covenant theology teaches that in history, God did have a physical, literal, biological seed line. And then God is calling out the church. And so what covenant theology, and I understand there are different flavors and shades and so on and so forth, but in general, covenant theology will recognize a literal physical Israel, but they also will teach that out of literal physical Israel is an Abrahamic seed which will ultimately fulfill the Abrahamic covenant. This seed is in accordance to the prophetic program. And what covenant theologians recognize is there's the physical and then there's the church. And they teach that the church has its beginnings in the Old Testament, and the so-called church gradually develops through history until its ultimate fulfillment in the New Testament. What passages do they use to teach or to support their doctrinal view that there is the two lines, one being literal, one being, quote, the church? Well, for example, in Romans chapter 9, verse 7, neither because they are the seed of Abraham are they all children, but in Isaac shall thy seed be called. Now, keep a little bookmark here. Go to Galatians chapter 3, Galatians chapter 3. And here are some passages that, the covenant system will use. In Galatians chapter 3, notice there, in verse 29, Galatians chapter 3, verse 29. And if ye be Christ's, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Now, that's a pretty strong passage, right? This passage is oftentimes used as a proof text. If Romans chapter 9 is identifying an Abrahamic seed, didn't Paul just say, and by the way, he's talking to the church of this current dispensational program, the church of the body of Christ. Notice he says, if ye be Christ, then are ye Abraham's seed. So wait a minute, here's the objection. Paul says, we are Abraham's seed. Therefore, by default, we are part of this spiritual seed line. By default, we are the benefactors of the Abrahamic covenant. We are the benefactors of what God intends to do in and through prophecy, so on and so forth. Go over to Galatians chapter 6, and here's another passage that the covenant system will use. This is obviously extremely weak, but Galatians chapter 6 and verse 16. And as many as walk according to this rule, peace be on them and mercy, and upon the Israel of God. Now, this is a silly passage to use because the assumption is, well, the church is the Israel of God. But that's not what the verse is saying, okay? I'm just sharing with you some of the passages that are oftentimes used to try to prove that we are part of this spiritual lineage that was prophesied about, that has its origins back there in the Old Testament, and that what God has been doing throughout all of human history is calling out this one singular church. So they therefore conclude that dispensationalism is wrong and it's evil. Certainly those who are proponents of, quote, mid-Acts dispensationalism, we're wrong, and our doctrine is heresy, it's evil, okay? By the way, might as well go to chapter 4, in Galatians chapter 4. Now, again, complete misreading of Galatians chapter 4, but let's just look at what passages are sometimes used to attack the dispensational teaching regarding the remnant and so forth, and the church and so forth. In Galatians chapter 4, notice there, we'll just break right into the context. Verse 24, Galatians 4:24, which things are an allegory, for these are the two covenants, the one from Mount Sinai, which gendereth to bondage, which is Agar, for this Agar is Mount Sinai in Arabia, and answereth to Jerusalem, which now is, and is in bondage with her children. But Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all. Now, you see how that verse can be used? Wait a minute. Jerusalem, which is above. Do you know a book of the Bible that has some tremendous detail about Jerusalem, which is above? The book of Revelation. Hey, and what does John see? He sees this city of God coming down, and that city is called the wife of the Lamb. Uh-oh. What now do we conclude? Wait a minute. Jerusalem is my mother. Therefore, I'm going to be in New Jerusalem. Therefore, I'm the wife of the Lamb, the so-called bride of Christ. And then John is given details about this glorious city that comes down. And, you know, they got the 12 gates and so on and so forth and the names of the 12 tribes of Israel. So wait a minute. If Jerusalem is my mother, and Jerusalem above is described in Revelation and so forth is coming down, then therefore I am a wife of the bride. I am the bride of Christ. This is all Jewish. It's all Jerusalem. It's all Israel. So you understand the way they're thinking about these passages. Keep reading, verse 27. For it is written, rejoice, thou barren that beareth not, break forth and cry, thou that travaileth not, for the desolate hath many more children than she which hath an husband. Now we, brethren, now this is where they make a huge, gross mistake. Read verse 28 again. Now we, brethren, as Isaac. Paul does something absolutely fascinating in the book of Galatians, as well as Romans chapter 4. We're going to get there, okay? When Paul deals with the Abrahamic lineage, in Romans 4 and in the book of Galatians, never, ever once does he suggest, imply, or hint, or teach, obviously, that we are part of this spiritual called out assembly, this spiritual remnant, this Israel of God. You know what Paul is always going to, what Paul does in his epistles, he lays out that Abrahamic lineage. And you know how that Abrahamic lineage works according to Paul's revelation? It goes from Abraham to Christ, from Christ to the church, the body of Christ. Critically important. Now, in Galatians 6, verse 28, now we, brethren, as, keep your finger there in Romans, go back to Romans chapter 9, and let's just note something critically important here. In Romans chapter 9, look there at verse 7 again, not because they are the seed of Abraham, are they all children, but in. Now, is there a difference between in Isaac and as Isaac? If Paul says in Galatians chapter 6, when we study who we are, our identity, what he does by way of an allegory, we'll go back there, an allegory. You know what an allegory is, right? An allegory conveys the complex and lays it out in a more easily understood way, okay? The Galatians are struggling. So Paul, in Galatians 6, he clearly says, listen, I'm going to use a teaching method, a legitimate teaching method called an allegory. And what an allegory does is it takes historical, you know, events, characters, figures, types, and facts, and so forth, to represent spiritual truths and spiritual principles. In other words, the Galatians aren't getting it. And we're not going to continue to demonstrate why the Galatians are. Remember what Paul says to the Galatians? Are you so foolish? Are you so foolish? Aren't you thinking about all of this? So when somebody's not thinking properly, there are a couple of techniques in teaching. You ask a bunch of questions, like Paul did. Wait a minute. Do you think you got the Spirit because of that? Do you think this? So what Paul did, well, Paul, he asks a series of questions. Why? Because you're not thinking properly. Well, if these saints at Galatia are, like Paul says, I'm travailing in birth again. When you deal with a preschooler, you don't lay out the calculus and the algebraic equations. When you're dealing with a preschooler, don't you have to, I'm exaggerating, you kind of take them by the hand, right? And you see this figure, it's a 1. And when you take a 1 plus a 1, you understand what I'm saying here, right? What Paul's doing with the Galatians is he's saying, listen, I'm going to have to use an allegory to emphasize and communicate what's happening here. In light of this allegory, in Galatians 6:28, he says, as Isaac. He doesn't say in Isaac. In Galatians chapter, I don't know what I said, disregard. Galatians chapter 6, verse 20, I'm sorry, in Galatians chapter 4, verse 28. Is that what I said? Okay, no. In Galatians 4:28, Paul says, as Isaac. In other words, there's a parallel here. In Romans 9, when Paul is literally dealing with historic Israel, he goes back to the Old Testament. He says, God's doing something in Isaac. In Isaac. And we already saw why there's a distinction there. Ishmael, the work of the flesh. Isaac, the miracle baby. Isaac was the son of promise. Remember that? And God, he's making a distinction. He's saying, listen, there is a seed line that has its origins through Ishmael, ultimately the apostate nation of Israel, the Edomites, rejecting everything that God is doing. But there is a seed line, Isaac, who has Jacob and so forth. Well, in Isaac, what God is saying is, that's how I'm going to establish this seed line. Paul never says we're in that seed line. He never says in Isaac when he writes to us. But he does say, as Isaac. Isaac was a child of promise. Guess what we learn via the Pauline revelation? We are children of promise. Oh, does that automatically mean by default that we are now somehow linked to this remnant that God has been calling out in history, that is the Old Testament, according to the prophetic program? See, that's where the mistake is made. You know, a couple of other passages that are sometimes used, and again, very weak, but go to Romans chapter 2. Romans chapter 2. Romans chapter 2. And in Romans chapter 2, again, if you are gripped by this covenant paradigm, this covenant system, you're going to read passages like Romans chapter 2. And notice there in Romans chapter 2, verse 25, for circumcision verily profiteth if thou keep the law, but if thou be a breaker of the law, thy circumcision is made uncircumcision. Therefore, if the uncircumcision keep the righteousness which of the law, shall not his uncircumcision be counted for circumcision, and shall not uncircumcision which is by nature, if it fulfill the law, judge thee, who by the letter and circumcision does transgress the law? Look at verse 28, for he is not a Jew which is one outwardly, neither is that circumcision which is outward in the flesh, but he is a Jew which is one inwardly, and circumcision is that of the heart in the spirit, not of the letter, whose praise is not of men but of God. So if you are trapped by covenant theology, you'll read that passage to say we become spiritual Jews. You see how you do that? Well, because, you know, the Gentile. Now again, Paul is not telling a Gentile how you become a spiritual Jew. You know what Paul is saying? Paul is talking to the Israelite. Look there at verse 17. Behold, thou art called a Jew, and resteth in the law, and maketh thy boast of God. So what Paul is doing in Romans chapter 2, and we've already been through this passage, he's telling the Jew that the issue with God, and he's quoting passages out of Deuteronomy. We were already back there, Deuteronomy 10, and I forgot whatever, but in the book of Deuteronomy, God told Israel, the issue is the circumcision of what? The heart. God is not saying, by the way, if you go back to Deuteronomy, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Did not God erect a wall of partition between Jew and Gentile? Book of Numbers, you know, you Israel are not going to be numbered among the Gentiles. It is absolutely clear that there is a distinction between Israel and all of the other nations. God is not saying, hey, all of you people in those other nations, you know what? I can make you a spiritual Jew. What God is telling Israel in the past is, you Israelites, you need something more than just mere physical circumcision, mere cutting off of physical flesh. God says in Deuteronomy 10, what I'm going to do to you is I'm going to cause and create a circumcision of the heart. You see, what Paul is saying to the Jew in Romans 2, in the context, is that a real Jew is one who is circumcised where? In the heart. Now, again, theology says, oh, no, no, God's telling the Gentile how to become a Jew. Now, you understand why there's kind of this whirlwind of theological views and disagreement and controversy. Obviously, if you've established a theological system, you're forced to interpret passages according to that theological system. So I understand why some would use Romans chapter 2, verse 28 especially, for he is not a Jew which is one outwardly. And he's telling a Gentile how to become one. No such thing. That's not what Paul's doing. What he's doing is he's shattering and dismantling this false illusion that the Jew has, that they are automatically by default God's people because they have been what? Physically circumcised. Did not Jesus Christ challenge that misconception in John chapter 8? Listen, just because you're the seed of Abraham doesn't mean you are the children of Abraham. See, the problem isn't the problem is the inward, okay? That's all Paul is doing, okay? But going back to Romans chapter 9. I'll go back to Romans chapter 9. So, okay, Romans chapter 9, verse 7. Neither because they are the seed of Abraham are they all children, but in Isaac shall thy seed be called. And now let's go to Galatians chapter 3 again. Galatians chapter 3. And let's compare this passage, this verse, with Galatians chapter 3. Now notice there in Galatians chapter 3, again, verse 29. Galatians 3, verse 29. And if ye be Christ's, Galatians 3:29, and if ye be Christ's, then are ye Abraham's seed. Oh boy, don't sweat, also no eminent. That sure sounds like we are Abraham's seed. And remember, we've already demonstrated what God's word has been doing, what God's word was doing in the past. He is establishing the seed line, and he's calling out a remnant. He's calling out a generation. Well, it sounds as though we are Abraham's seed. And some now conclude then, well, we are what's happening in the Old Testament. And yeah, you know what? God all along has been calling out this spiritual church. First of all, notice verse 29. Verse 29 does not say, and if ye be in Abraham, then, I'm sorry, it does not say, if ye be Abraham's seed, then are you in Christ. Notice that. Verse 29 does not say, if you are in Abraham, or if you are Abraham's seed, then are you in Christ. What does the verse say? If ye be Christ's, then are you what? Abraham's. A real important distinction. Paul's establishing a genealogy, if you will, a lineage. And when dealing with us today, it's always Christ, which then takes us to Abraham. Out of Abraham, we're going to find out, you know, there are four seeds. Go to Galatians chapter 3, look there at verse 16. Galatians 3, verse 16. Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He saith, not to seeds of many, but as of one, and to thy seed, which is what? Wait a minute, is Christ a seed? Yeah. Does Abraham have a seed? Yes. Are we Abraham's seed? Yeah, verse 29, right? And if ye be Christ, then are ye Abraham's what? Oh, no. We are spiritual Israelites. We are spiritual Jews. We are the benefactors of all that God has predicted and promised in prophecy. And therefore, we are now ultimately the fulfillment of the Abrahamic covenant. Now, you understand? That's how covenant theology works. Okay? So let's just sort of understand what Paul is saying about Abraham's seed. Let's make a distinction here. There is in the Bible a physical seed, a literal physical seed. But in the Bible, there is also a spiritual seed. We have to make that distinction. But Galatians, now Pauline revelation, I want to emphasize that. When you come to Paul's epistles, you know what he says? Wait a minute, there's a third seed. Who's the third seed? Christ. And then he's emphasizing at the end of chapter 3, but wait a minute, if we're in Christ, then we are what? Abraham's seed. So how many seeds do we have so far? Four. We're Abraham's seed. Christ is a seed. There is, as we've demonstrated already, there's a spiritual seed line. And there's obviously, like Romans 9 is establishing, a literal, physical, biological seed line, all right? A lot of seed out there, right? I just want to, so more time. Paul deals with us via Christ back to Abraham. Now, book of Matthew. Let's just compare for a moment. Go to Matthew chapter 1. Go to Matthew chapter 1. And prophetically, this is an important distinction to make. And that's what, by the way, isn't that what right division is all about? Rightly what? Dividing. Well, dividing means, you know, you handle it right. And oh, amen, God divided the light from the what? From the darkness, right? King Solomon said, bring me a sword. I'm going to divide the child in half. Don't let somebody argue that. No, divide means you're correctly handling it. Divide means you divide it. It means there is a distinction. There is a separation that God has already implanted. Okay? What I'm trying to do here is, listen, when we rightly divide the word of truth, critically important, Paul's lineage to Abraham is different than, for example, look here in Matthew chapter 1, verse 1, the book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham begat Isaac, and Isaac begat Jacob, and Jacob begat Judas and his brethren. And then you fly all the way right down to verse 16, and Jacob begat Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom was born Jesus. So, prophetically, the seed line back to Abraham, do you notice how it is linked with who? Isaac, Jacob, Israel. And what we learn in prophecy, especially, you know, the gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and by the way, in the book of Acts as well, Peter, we'll look at Peter. By the way, Peter's going to do the same thing. When the so-called New Testament deals with the lineage of Jesus Christ, it takes you back to this physical lineage. We just read it, right? Go to Luke chapter 3. Luke chapter 3. We're just trying to recognize a distinction in lineage. Because Paul never does this. In fact, isn't it interesting, as in Matthew 1, and we're going to see here in Luke chapter 3, Isaac is a big deal. And remember what we read in Romans chapter 9. In Isaac, I better write this down, in Isaac shall thy seed be called. And so we have this constant lineage. It's being recorded. It's being preserved, okay? In Isaac, because he's the promised one. He's the miracle baby. Not of works, right? Not of works at all. Oh, somebody had a good question here. Wait a minute. I made the statement a couple of weeks ago that Abraham was impotent and Sarah's womb was dead, right? But wait a minute. Hey, Jomo. Man, good seeing you, buddy. So wait a minute. But didn't Sarah have more children after Isaac? She did. Well, got to remember, when God enlivened Sarah's womb, she was now able to have children, okay? So, you know, don't be, you know, wait a minute. How can you say that her womb was dead and, you know, God gave Isaac as a miracle baby? Some people think that then her womb was dead after Isaac. No, she had more children. Why? What did God do? He miraculously brought the womb back to life, okay? So I just wanted to point that out very, very quickly. Luke chapter 3, verse 23. Luke 3, verse 23. And Jesus himself began to be about 30 years of age, being, as was supposed, the son of Joseph, which was the son of Heli. And then if you read on down and stop at verse 34, which was the son of Jacob, which was the son of Isaac, which was the son of Abraham. Okay, you see the significance and the importance, right? Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision to confirm the promises that were made who to the fathers over and over again. The father, Isaac, a physical, literal, biological seed line. The prophets will link the Lord Jesus Christ back to who? The physical lineage. Paul never does that in connection to the body of Christ. He never does that. Here, it's what? In. You see the significance? For us, it's what? Remember the allegory? I'm going to spoon feed you Gerber, baby food. That's what Paul's doing. Here's an analogy. You just can't, the Galatians couldn't handle the clear teaching. So Paul says, let me use some figurative language. Paul never says in Isaac, Paul deliberately, carefully, skillfully disassociates our lineage from what? This biological seed line. The spiritual seed line, by the way, comes from where? It comes from Isaac. It comes from a physical seed line. Well, wait a minute. If Paul says not in Isaac, but as Isaac, how do we get in on what God is doing? Through Christ. And if ye be Christ's, then are ye Abraham's seed. Now, we still haven't answered, well, what does it mean to be Abraham's seed? Covenant theology says, no, that means we're over here, okay? And Paul's never going to do that. Never is he going to do that. If you want to go to Acts, now, you know what? We're not going to go to Acts. You know that Peter does the same thing. I just want to point this out. Peter will do the same thing. When dealing with Christ's spirit, lineage, he takes you right back. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Okay? Out of the physical, a spiritual. Now, what is Paul doing in Romans 9? Remember what Paul is doing in Romans 9. He's not teaching Gentiles how we're connected to Abraham. You know what he's... Who is Paul addressing in Romans chapter 9? Israel. And the Jew is objecting. They're accusing Paul of lying. Remember what Paul says, I lie not? Why does Paul have to say, I'm not lying. Unless you're being accused of what? Paul is saying, listen, this physical lineage isn't the lineage that God is dealing with. And immediately the cry is, you liar. What Paul is doing in Romans 9 is he's saying God's word was always doing something within the ranks of that physical nation. What was God's word doing? Now go to Matthew chapter 21 real quick. Matthew chapter 21. What the Lord Jesus Christ is doing is Matthew chapter 21. He's actually doing what the prophets were predicting, what God's word was doing in time past. In Matthew chapter 21. Matthew chapter 21. Look there at verse 43, Matthew 21, verse 43. Therefore say unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you. And he's talking about to the apostates, right? And given to a nation. Okay, you're in Jerusalem. As a Jew in Jerusalem, there are only two nations in 2,000 years ago, if you were a resident of Jerusalem and in the land of Israel, there were only two nations that a Jew recognized. What were the two nations at that time, historically 2,000 years ago? Israel, and guess who else? Or what? Rome. Is Jesus Christ saying to these apostate leaders of Israel, whose father is the devil, ye are of your father who? The devil. But Jesus said, yeah, you are the seed of Abraham, right? Jesus Christ had no problem acknowledging that these apostates are the seed of Abraham. How? Not by way of Isaac, but by way of who? Edom? Esau? Now, ultimately, Ishmael. Now, Esau was not a child of Ishmael. I understand that. But these apostates, they're Edomites, figuratively speaking. I'm figuratively saying they're Edomites, okay? So the Lord, is he saying it's going to be taken from you apostates and given to he's going to give it to Rome? What other nation exists when Christ says, I'm taking it from you Jews, from you Israelites, from you Hebrews, and I'm going to give it to another nation, nations or nation, one, singular, right? Well, their only other nation there in the land is Rome. Go over to Luke chapter 12. Well, of course the Lord Jesus isn't saying, I'm going to give the kingdom to Rome. What other nation? Jesus Christ, go to Luke chapter 12. Luke chapter 12. And let us turn back to Genesis chapter 25. Remember, was God's word working? Should a Jew in Christ's day have been absolutely dumbfounded and baffled when the Lord's talking about another nation? All you got to do is read Genesis, right? The first book of the Bible. Look there at Genesis chapter 25. And remember there in Genesis chapter 25, verse 23. Genesis 25, verse 23. And the Lord said unto her, to what? So in God's thinking, how many nations are there? There's only two. Now, we understand what is at least one nation that we are absolutely sure he's talking about, Israel. So that leaves how many more nations? That only leaves one more nation. Genesis is already establishing a fundamental principle. When God is dealing with Israel, he's not just dealing with one singular group of people or one singular nation. How many nations is he acknowledging? Two. Going back to physical, and then the Old Testament prophecy develops the other one. Jesus Christ says, I'm going to take that nation from you apostates, and I'm going to give it to a what? Another. You know, if somebody understood the Old Testament, boom, you know what should have popped right in their mind? Genesis chapter 25, yeah. What did the Lord mean that there were two nations in Sarah's womb? Two nations. One that he loves and one that he hates. Was God's word working back in Genesis? Now, remember the objection being raised before Paul. Not as though the word of God has taken on effect. Israel's telling Paul, you're a fat liar. Paul says, are you kidding me? By the way, did Paul have access to the scriptures? The problem is never God's word. The problem is God's people. Did Paul know the book of Genesis? Did Paul have access to the book of Genesis as a Pharisee, Hebrew of the Hebrews, right? I mean, he blew every other peer within the ranks of the religious. Why didn't Paul get it? Because I did it how? In unbelief. Paul understood, I'm here in the nation that's hated by God. Paul, he didn't have what God was looking for over 1,500 years. God's looking for faith. He's looking for a faith response. And if you had a faith response, you would have recognized who the anointed one was. That's what Peter does, by the way, in Acts chapter 7. You know what Peter does in Acts chapter 7? Listen, Israel, we had access. We understand Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, on and on. And yet Israel rejected the anointed one. Why? Did God's word fail? Didn't God's word provide the signposts and the fingerprints and the details? And all you got to do is read them. By the way, isn't it comforting to know? You have these religious bigots wearing the costumes, and you have these insignificant individuals at the temple waiting for the coming Messiah. Just because you've got the theological degrees, and you've got the church, and you've got the following, you're still possibly going to hell. And here you have these no-named individuals waiting for redemption in Jerusalem. That's a comfort, right? Listen, the Bible's not difficult. The Bible's not hard. It just has to be believed. That's all God's looking for, okay? This accusation, God's word, isn't working then. Now, by the way, isn't that what a proud, arrogant response is? Well, maybe if God was doing his job. God was doing his job all along, okay? Luke chapter 12. Luke chapter 12. So wait, God's word already taught there is a remnant doctrine. In Luke chapter 12, who or what is this nation? Luke chapter 12 and verse 32. Luke 12, verse 32. Fear not, little flock. Uh-oh. For it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the what? All right. It's pretty simple, right? I'm going to take the kingdom from you, unbelieving rejectors, and I'm going to give it to another what? Nation. And God, Jesus Christ is reaffirming what was already established in Genesis chapter 25. There are two nations in God's dealings with the nation of Israel. One he hates, one he loves. And here he identifies that one nation. Who are the people of this one nation? They're the little what? The little flock. That's the nation. The little flock. In keeping with all that prophecy, remember, a generation is going to be born. A seed is going to be called out. It's the spiritual component. And don't get me wrong, there is still a physical component, right? Didn't Jesus say you're going to sit on 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of what? There is still a literal physical component. But more than that, there is a spiritual component. And Jesus Christ, he's making that distinction between those two people groups. What is Paul doing in Romans chapters 9, 10, and 11 especially? Go back to Romans and notice Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10. Oh, please, Romans 9, 10, and 11 is not communicating to Gentiles how they become a part of spiritual Israel or this regenerated Israel or this little flock or this nation that God says, I love. No, Paul is directing all of these details to Israel as a whole to provide an explanation as to why God has the right to suspend prophecy. God has every right to suspend prophecy. He's dealing with Israel. Romans chapter 10. And notice there in verse 19. Thou wilt say then, I'm sorry, 10 verse 19. But I say, did not Israel... Didn't Israel know about this? You better believe Israel should have known about. First Moses saith, I will provoke you to jealousy by them that are no people and by a foolish nation. Oh, that's it. That's the Gentiles, right? What? Again, don't let your preconceived theological leaning and the foolish nation. Wait a minute. There are two nations in Sarah's womb. Jesus Christ says, I'm going to take it from one nation and I'm going to give it to this other nation. This provoking, this foolish nation is the little flock, the ones that Jesus is calling out. The ones, by the way, John the Baptist. Remember what John the Baptist said. What did John the Baptist start yelling when he saw the Pharisees coming? Remember, he didn't say, hey, you guys need to get water baptized. What did John the Baptist say to the nation that God hated? That is Esau, who's warned you guys to flee the wrath to come. And remember what John says right after that. And don't say you have Abraham as what? Why did John say that? John the Baptist, he's confronting Israel and immediately he's establishing the remnant doctrine. You, biological, physical, listen. Don't you claim you're Abraham's seed because God can take a rock. You see what he's doing there? What Paul's doing in Romans 9, 10, 11. Go to chapter 9, verse 27. Romans 9, 27. Romans 9, 27. Esaias also crieth concerning who? Is he talking to Gentiles? Though the number of the children of Israel be as the sand of the sea, a remnant. He's not talking to Gentiles and how it is we are the true spiritual Jew. He's saying, Israel, remember God's word was working. Isaiah had something to say. Listen, we already know Genesis has something to say. Isaiah has something to say. And you know what? Israel, there's a what? A remnant. A nation within a nation. Verse 29. And as Isaiah saith before, except the Lord of Sabaoth had left us a seed, we had been as Sodom and been made like unto Gomorrah. A seed. Now, that's the spiritual. We got the physical, but there's a spiritual seed. Chapter 10, verse 19. Chapter 10, verse 19. We already read that. At the end of the verse, a foolish nation. Look at verse 20. But Esaias is very bold and saith, I was found of them that sought me not. I was made manifest unto them that asked not after me. He's talking about that remnant in chapter 11, verse 5. Even so then, at this present time also, there is a what? Remnant. Remember, 9, 10, 11 is an indictment against Israel for her obstinate rejection of what God's word was saying all along. And Paul is simply telling Israel, God was dealing with the spiritual component the whole time. A seed, a holy seed, a godly seed, a regenerated seed. That's the nation. All right. How then do we handle Galatians chapter 9, especially there at verse 20? Go to Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3. How do we then handle verse 29? Galatians 3, verse 29. And if ye be Christ's, then are ye Abraham's seed. Nothing about Isaac here. Nothing about Jacob here. All, but this is what Paul deliberately does. Christ, and body of the church, the body of Christ, to Christ, then to Abraham. And notice in verse 14, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through who? Jesus Christ, through Isaac. Wait a minute. Didn't Paul emphasize in Romans chapter 9, in Isaac shall thy seed be called? What, does Paul take us back to Isaac? No. Verse 14, quite obvious, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through, notice, Jesus Christ. And then, of course, we read verse 16, now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He saith not, and to seeds of many, but as of one, and to thy seed, which is Christ. Look there at verse 26. For ye, you Galatians, you the body of Christ, for ye are all the children of God by faith, where? In Christ Jesus. Over and over again, what we learn is that our lineage back to Abraham, it comes through Jesus Christ. But wait, how is it that we are Abraham's seed? Keep your finger here. Go to Romans chapter 4. Look there in Romans chapter 4. And here's another passage that can confuse. Romans chapter 4 and verse 11. Romans chapter 4, verse 11. And he, talking about Abraham, received the sign of circumcision, a seal of the righteousness of the faith, which he had yet being uncircumcised, that he might be the father of all them that believe. Romans 4 is not teaching Israel about the remnant. Nor is Romans 4 telling the Gentiles, hey, you are the prophesied remnant. What Romans 4 and Galatians 3 is doing is, hey, you know what God did to Abraham? He did it before Isaac was even born. 30 years before Isaac was even born. You see the wisdom of God here? Listen, this spiritual component, a literal physical seed line, out of which Christ came, out of which there will be literally 12 tribes functioning on the earth, reigning over the Gentiles, by the way. That's a real, but what does Paul do? Paul takes us to Abraham before Isaac by 30 years. Deliberately, God, there's this barrier, there's this separation between Abraham and Isaac. In fact, what happens to Abraham happens about 10 to 15 years before the act of what? Circumcision. Paul is always going to Genesis chapter 15 when talking about Abraham, hence links us to Christ and so forth. So here we read again in verse 11, and he received the sign of circumcision, a seal of the righteousness of the faith which he had, yet being uncircumcised by around 15 years, that he might be the father of all them that what? Believe. Though they be not circumcised, that righteousness might be imputed unto them also. And the father of circumcision to them who are not of the circumcision only, but who walk in the steps of that faith of our father Abraham, which he had yet being uncircumcised. For the promise that he should be the heir of the world was not to Abraham through his seed through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. Look there at verse 16. Therefore, it is of faith that it might be by grace to the end the promise might be sure to all the seed, not to that only which is of the law, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. Is Paul talking about Isaac? Is he talking about a physical lineage? Of course not. He's talking about what God did in his infinite wisdom 30 years before Isaac is even born. And he says, guess what? God fixed it so that Abraham qualifies to be the father of all who what? Believe. There's the dual fatherhood of Abraham. Now, prior to Paul, who would have had the audacity to say, can you imagine a Babylonian running into the nation of Israel, says, Abraham is my dad. You understand? You see why Paul's called a liar? Why Paul? I lie not. Abraham is the father of all them that, and this is the key, that believe. Go back to Galatians chapter 3. Yeah, we are Abraham's seed in the way in which Abraham received imputed righteousness. Okay? We're not Abraham's seed by way of Isaac and the forefathers. Never, ever, ever does Paul even imply that. He uses careful language. He says, wait a minute, as Isaac, promise. You see that? God made a promise. We got time. You know that God already made a promise to himself before he created the heaven and the earth? And God said, I'm going to make a promise to give Renee. Now, I'm not saying God made a promise that he was going to give eternal life. How? By faith. God says, I make a promise to myself. I'm going to provide a redeemer. And you know, it really is, and it's almost sounds almost like heresy. You have the Father, you have the Son, and you have the Holy Spirit. And all three persons, they made a promise to themselves. Think you promise? That all of those lost Gentiles worthy and qualified to spend eternity with Satan, we're going to give them eternal life as a free gift when they respond by faith to what Christ Jesus agreed to do. Jesus Christ said, Dad, you love them, I'll be that sacrifice. And when he made himself no reputation, you know that Jesus Christ did not take advantage of his position as God? That's what it says. Who made himself no reputation. Jesus deliberately said, I will not access nor take advantage of my inherent right as God. But I'll put it off. Took upon himself the form of a servant, was made in the likeness of man, and so forth, became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Look, God made a promise way back before Genesis 1:1. And the promise is, and Abraham, what God did with and through Abraham, qualifies Abraham to be the father of all them that believe. That includes us. Galatians chapter 3, verse 5. Galatians 3, verse 5. Abraham is our father. We are the seed of Abraham in the way in which Abraham received righteousness. Galatians chapter 3, And notice there, verse 5. He therefore that ministereth to you the Spirit and worketh miracles among you, doth he it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith, even as Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him for righteousness. Know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of who? How are we the seed of Abraham? Because we respond by faith to the claims and message of Almighty God today. Sorry, Isaac, you're not my dad. But what God's doing to me, it's like what God did to Isaac. See that? As Isaac, not in Isaac. Five important things. I'm just going to rattle them off. What is significant about the way Abraham was justified or had imputed? Number one, was it in circumcision or before circumcision? He was righteous. He received imputed righteousness before he was circumcised. Did he receive it because of what he did in the flesh or in spite of what he was doing in the flesh? In spite of what he was trying to do in the flesh. Did Abraham receive righteousness because or via the works of the law? Wait a minute. God was dealing with Abraham 400 years prior to the law. Did God do what he did with Abraham, giving him righteousness by faith alone? All he said was, I believe you. And God said, I just gave you righteousness, Abraham. How did Abraham know he had righteousness? God told him he had righteousness. And then, of course, Paul emphasizes in verse 12. Look there at verse 12. Verse 12 of Galatians chapter 3. And the law is not of faith, but the man that doeth them shall live in them. It's not of faith. Drop down to verse 18. For if the inheritance be of the law, it is no more of promise. Here we go. But God, what's that next word? Gave it to Abraham. How? Gave it. It's not by works. It's not by the law. It's not by self, works, effort that achieves, attains, and qualifies. God gave it. You understand what? He gave it to him. What did Abraham do? He believed God. So yes, we are Abraham's seed, without a doubt. God is doing to us what he did. He gave Abraham eternal life by promise. He gave it. Guess how he deals with us today? By promise. He gives it. By grace are you saved through grace, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. You know, sometimes we come up with definitions for grace. You know, the Bible defines grace. What does grace mean? And that not of yourselves. That's what grace means. Not of yourselves. You are excluded from what God is doing. All God wants is your belief. Father, we do thank you for your grace and for your love. We thank you that we are the seed of Abraham by way of faith and the application of faith and how it is you gave it as a free gift. We thank you, Lord, that it's possible because of Christ that we are in Christ. And because we are in Christ, we now are Abraham's seed. May we never be confused with the prophetic plan and operation regarding Israel and the little flock and the foolish nation and that regenerated nation. May we understand what you're doing today is completely separate, completely distinct, and yet we do appreciate and value the commonality that is that Abraham is the father of us all because of his faith. We thank you, Lord, for that truth, and we thank you in Christ's name.